Good morning. It is good to be in the house of the Lord with God's people. So, as we know, our sister congregation up at Narana has a very significant vote today after church, so keep them in your prayers, especially right shortly after noon when they are gathering to have that very important congregational meeting. And of course, it has implications for the whole parish. So our prayers, our thoughts, and our shared wisdom with one another goes with them as we continue to minister together whatever happens. We are God's people in this place, in God's kingdom. And this is an important part of God's church because of all of the people in here and around us. We all need to hear the gospel and experience the gospel, which is the good news that we are one in Christ. That'll continue to happen, whatever happens. We don't need to worry. But we have a bunch of announcements in here, and there's a bunch of stuff up on the screen, so I'm sure everybody's been reading everything that they missed in the coffee shop and at the post office. But we'll keep updated on that. And is there anything else that needs to be mention? Is anybody like to? Yes, John.
It was in early August that we harvested our I guess it was about 97, 98 acres of peas, yellow peas, and we got 48 bushel an acre off of it, which is tremendous on a year like this. And so we sold it through Pioneer, and they worked their stuff again, and we ended up with $46,205 and change, and with our other stuff that we've had tremendous support from our suppliers and our elevators and input dealers and machinery dealers and everything, we were able to send $48,000 on to Winnipeg. $48,000, and it's matched up to 4-1, so that all told could end up being $240,000. So thank God for all that he has done for us. Every year we say we have divine intervention with our project, and it's always turned out tremendous. So thank you to everyone that supported us.
Wow. What a beautiful, life-giving, life-affirming ministry that is. We are really, literally feeding the world, doing our part. So that's so exciting to see, and for us to be a part of that. Yeah. And you know, we broke 46,000 loaves. And 200,000 loaves appeared. You know, it's a little miraculous thing going on there. Anything else? I don't think anybody can top that. With that, we're using our red book, our ELW, for our worship this morning, Service of the Word. And our hymns are also all coming out of the red book today. So that's nice and simple. Our opening hymn is number 685.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Kyrie.
Together in prayer of the day, let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants, because we cannot rely on our own abilities. Grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our first lesson.
Our first lesson is from Jonah, chapter 3, verses 10 to 4 and 11. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I know that you are gracious and a merciful God, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relenting from punishment. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, It is right for you to be angry. Then Jonah went out of the city, sat down east of the city, and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it to come up over Jonah. It gave shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, It is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, It is right for you to be angry about the bush. And he said, Yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, You are concerned about the bush for which you did not labor and which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 persons who don't know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? The psalm is Psalm 145, verses 1 to 8. I will read the first part, and I'll have the congregation lead the indented part. I will exalt you, my Lord and King,
and bless your name forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you and praise your name. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
There is no end to your greatness.
One generation shall praise your works to another,
and shall declare your power.
I will speak to the glorious splendor of your majesty,
and all your marvelous works.
They shall tell you of the might of your wondrous acts,
and I will recount your greatness.
They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness,
and they shall sing joyfully of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion,
slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The epistle lesson, Philippians chapters 1, 21 to 30. For me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, yet I cannot say which I choose. I'm hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, but it is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that by my presence again with you, your boast might abound in Christ Jesus because of me. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit. You or am absent to hear from you in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and in no afraid frightened by opposing you. For them, this is evidence of your destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only believing in Christ, but suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. So that's the reading.
Turn to hymn number 765. Thank you. Let us turn to our gospel acclamation. The gospel lesson for this 17th Sunday after Pentecost is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, the 20th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus is teaching, and he says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, 'You also, go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' They said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' He said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner said to his master, his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received a denarius. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received a denarius. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I gave to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?' So the last will be first, and the first will be last." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Resentment. Resentment is a toxic thing. See, the old 12-step saying is that resentment is like drinking poison and then sitting down and waiting for the other person to die. It doesn't work. It is the product of a heart that cannot manage to let go and forgive. And resentment harms the person who holds it. Holding on to resentment is just like holding on to a lap full of hot coals. It's not going to go well for you. Let's take a look at Jonah. Jonah is just a shining, resilient, glowing example of resentment in our lesson. He's been sent, remember how that story goes? He's sent by God, "Go and preach to Nineveh, that wicked city, that they must repent and turn from their ways." And Jonah said, "Yes, Lord, right away." And he runs the opposite direction and tries to get away and out of the job. And he ends up on the beach after adventures, covered in fish vomit, trudging into the city, squish, squish, squish. And obviously, people would notice somebody who marches into the city covered in fish vomit. So he obviously draws a crowd. The smell alone would bring a lot of people out to see what's going on here. And he proclaims, Just 30 days and God will destroy you for your wicked, evil deeds. And all the people take it seriously. Now remember, this is unlike what was happening in Israel at the time with the prophets of the Lord who were coming to the people and saying, God is going to strike you because you're not following God's commands. You're not loving one another. You're not caring for one another. You're not taking care of the land. You're not doing any of the things you're supposed to do to flourish. And the people said, oh, shut up and get out of here. We know what we're doing. But the people of Nineveh repent and they put on clothing that is reflective of repentance and of sorrow, mourning clothes, the clothing of grief. And they put dust and ashes on their heads as signs that they are mourning for their wicked deeds. Everyone from the king to the lowest servant in the lowest household, and even the animals repent. And Jonah said, I knew it. You are a God who is merciful and gracious and abounding in steadfast love, slow to anger and quick to forgive, and I hate it. Because these people, I don't like them. Nineveh was the head of the empire that was crushing Israel. So, of course, those underneath the force of that imperial power were angry. They were justly upset, justly grieved. But there's a difference between just grief and just grievances and harboring, holding on to, and nurturing resentment. Jonah wasn't running away because he was afraid of failing. He was running away because he was afraid he might succeed. And God indeed proved full of mercy, as our psalm says, gracious, ready to pardon. God had no time for resentment. You can see the resentment in Jonah. He's so resentful, he wants to die. Just kill me if you're going to do this kind of thing. And God says, is it right that you should be angry? Because I've done something good for people. And because people have listened to my word, is that why you should be angry? And Jonah says, yes, angry enough to die. Boy, that's pretty peeved. So God sends a little sign, a bush. And you know, trees and bushes, they're God's air conditioners. And it's hot in the Middle East. And Jonah is hunkering in his little makeshift shelter of sticks. He's like Eeyore, sitting there in the rain with the rain pouring down, sitting under a bundle of sticks, pretending that he's going to be taking care of himself. And God sends a refreshing, cooling air underneath a bush, and then the bush dies. And God says, okay, what do you make of that? And Jonah says, I don't like it. I'm mad. I'm angry. I'm resentful. And God said, you know, I made this bush appear one day and disappear the next, and it was for your good and for your learning. The bush was doing good things for you, and then it was gone. And now you're resentful about that too. And here you are resentful mainly over somebody being forgiven because they repented. But God does that all the time for every one of us. Every one of us are given opportunities to repent, turn and mend our ways daily, sometimes moment by moment on a rough day. And when we pay attention to God's call and turn and follow God's way, which is the way of forgiveness and repentance and repair and restoration, when we follow that way instead of our own resentful way of holding on to grudges and grievances, well, you know, life turns out to be pretty darn good. But we can also have the option of hanging on to those grievances and just clutching them tight, like a lap full of burning coals. Yeah, that's really helpful. Interesting that God mentions the animals here too. If he had decided to not proclaim this and to simply rain down fire and brimstone on them, not only would the people suffer, but even the donkeys and the cats and the dogs, the animals of the city. God is gracious to those who repent and to those who don't even have the capacity to understand what it means to repent. Grace and mercy abounds. Does our grace and mercy abound too? Are we actually following God's will, or do we just have some of these resentments that we like to hold on to? So Jesus is talking about the same kind of thing. God's reign, God's realm, the place where God is in control, and what it's like. The place, in fact, where it turns out things aren't really that fair in a lot of ways. The standard daily wage for a laborer in the ancient world at the time of Jesus was the Roman coin, the denarius, which gave you enough to buy food and shelter and such if you got one every day. It was kind of the standard minimum wage of the day. But it was enough to survive on. His workers are hired in the morning, and the landowner takes them, and they work all day, and they bring the harvest off. But of course, you know what harvest is like. You'll want to get it off while it's good. You don't want stuff standing out. You don't want crops standing out there at the end of the season to get ruined by the end of the season and the fall of the snow in that country. It's not snow, but it's drought that would come next, dry everything up. So you try to get that crop off as quick as you can. So the man goes back out a little later and he finds guys who are too lazy to get up early in the morning and be there at the standard hiring time. They got up not at the crack of dawn to be there when people were going out to the fields, but they get up, kind of relaxed later on, 9 o'clock, mid-morning, brunch. And, they're obviously not that serious about getting in a full day's work. But they get hired anyway. Because there's lots of crop. It's got to be brought in. So he goes back out again at noon. Well, these guys are real go-getters. Man, these are the hard-working types. They're sleeping in till noon. Obviously, they were playing video games the night before. So they get in, drift into the town square, and they get hired too and sent out into the field to work. "I'll give you what's fair," he says. Well, I'm sure they're assuming a half day's wage for a half day's work. He even hires more in the mid-afternoon. Now, these guys obviously have been out carousing the night before if they couldn't get out of the house until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And what about the lollygaggers who sleep all day and get into trouble at night? The ones who are getting up at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, just in time for a breakfast supper. He hires them. So when he pays everybody the same amount of wages, those who work the full day obviously have a grievance. "You've made us equal to these lazy bums. That's not fair." But really, they contracted for what they contracted. The only ones who agreed to the amount that they would get were the only ones who were complaining about the amount they got. Isn't that interesting? They signed the contract saying, "Okay, one denarius, we'll work for a standard day's wage." And they complained when they didn't get a bonus. Oh, we can always figure out things to complain about, can't we? We can be driving a nice, reliable, solid vehicle and complain that we don't have a Ferrari or a Rolls-Royce that goes past us on the highway. But we've got what we need. We're fine. There's no real reason to complain. But, you know, humans, we don't necessarily need a reason to complain. Remember what Brent Butt sang, Saskatchewan, his song? Complain about the rain, complain about the sun, complain about the wind, because complaining's kind of fun. And you have a 40 of rye when the day is done, because nothing rhymes with Saskatchewan. But like the angry workers, Jonah, he wanted extra credit. I'm better than these rotten Ninevites. Where's my cookie? I'm a faithful follower of God. I even preach for him. But God says, no, Jonah, they got the message. They got their salvation that you called for. They heard the good news. The Ninevites and the whole city of Nineveh is delivered. But Jonah just hangs on to that resentment. So much so that he could not face living in a realm, a kingdom of generosity. He wants to die. Mercy is shown to obviously bad people, meaning the people that Jonah didn't like. Well, that kind of stings a little, doesn't it? Because there's certain people that we'll feel uncomfortable with. And those are the people that God also shows mercy to. Who are the bad people that we would like to see God crush? Who are the bad people that we would crush in God's name? Like if we, each one of us, listens deeply in our heart, we'll find somebody there in that position. People that we hold a resentment against, that we just want to see them get their just deserts. Those are the people of Nineveh. Those are also the lazy latecomers who slept in till noon or later, and yet God grants them grace. Those are the welfare bums of the world, the people that God calls, the people that God declares forgiven, the people that God provides with what they need just to survive. Will we rejoice in their forgiveness, in their abundance? Or will we hang on to our resentments? The choice is ours. It's not easy to forgive and let go of resentments, but it is Christ-like. Amen. We turn together to our hymn of the day, number 770. Thank you. us together confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of life and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. God of all your people, we thank you for the call upon our hearts to follow you. Help us always to remember that we are yours, and that all that we have comes from you, Lord, in your mercy. God of all people, make us humble as we encounter those of other faiths. Remind us that however wise we may feel we are, there is always much more to know. May we never forget that our finite minds we'll always have more to learn, and may we have the humility to learn from others. Lord, in your mercy. God of this abundant creation, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the rich harvest brought in by our food grains bank this year. May it be blessed richly as it is poured out into the laps of those who receive with gratitude. May all receive the food they need to thrive and not just survive. We are blessed with great abundance. Keep us mindful that we did not create the world, but that we benefit from its abundance, and also that you have called us to care for this treasure with humble and careful hearts. Lord, in your mercy. God of grace and mercy, we pray for all people who are in need, some near to us, many far from us, but all connected to us. We lift up before you all of those in our Last Mountain Pioneer home, residents and staff. We pray for those who care for us when we are ill, and those who provide our needs when we are struck down and suffering. Cause us ever to hear you when we hear the cries of those who are in pain and in need. May our hearts break as yours does whenever there is suffering. And may we always be on the watch for ways that we may love and care for all we are able to help in any way. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for our parish in this time of change and uncertainty. Make us patient with each other. Make us kind to each other. And may we always be open to your creative call, listening for your call to what is new. We give you thanks for the ministry we have as your people in this place. Teach us ever to love each other more effectively and more creatively. Lord, in your mercy. We lift up before you at this time all those whom you have placed on our hearts, naming them before your throne of mercy. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for those who've gone as before us into your rest. May we follow in the footsteps of the faithful, so that in the end we may rest in your arms and be a sign of faithful living to those who come after us. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Share a sign of peace with one another as is appropriate. Peace to those who join us on the camera. You are with us too. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace, Marvin. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace. Peace be with you. Peace, June.
Oh,
peace be with you. You don't have to be, you know, in a hurry to shut down. You know, you just keep going a little extra. It's fine. But this time we will take a few moments to receive our offerings. Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God. For by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
By your word you called to your people, Israel, to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God.
We give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Beautiful, abundant, forgiving people. May we always be willing to offer that which we have to those who have less, that we all might survive and thrive and be one in the abundant world God has given us. Amen. We turn to our closing hymn, 669. So it's good we're already standing because we don't have to rise up. We can already be risen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.